journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
To the service of the nation.
We talk to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
It's the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Good morning, I'm Mike Yoreta. Here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. The Philippines Health Secretary gets emotional while defending his agency's pandemic spending amid alleged deficiencies. More hospitals in Metro Manila are declaring full capacity. Mayors in the region are set to announce their quarantine recommendation today. And nearly three dozen Filipinos evacuated from Afghanistan return home in Manila. Philippine Health Secretary Francisco Duque III gets emotional while defending his agency's pandemic spending before lawmakers. This after the Commission on Audit cited numerous deficiencies related to how the health department used over 67 billion pesos in budget for last year's pandemic response. Secretary Duque told the House Committee on Public Accounts that he found the COA's report both unfair and hurtful.
Winarap na ninyo kami eh. Winarap na ninyo ang dangal ng DOH. It's really unfair, unjust that this judgment has been handed down clearly without giving the DOH the full 60 days within which we should have given our rejoinder.
The chairperson of the Commission on Audit, Michael Aguinaldo, meanwhile, asserts.
Yung audit report is a requirement by law that has to come out. Before an audit report is issued, there is a lot of due process that is actually followed. Meron pa yung exit conference. Meron pong recommendations yan. And it's those recommendations which the department is given 60 days.
The DOH says that they have addressed some of the issues noted by the COA and that they are now working on its other recommendations. A Senate committee is also set to conduct a separate investigation into the health department's alleged misuse of its COVID-19 funds. The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee will open its motu proprio investigation today to look into the audit commission's report and the DOH's alleged mismanagement of over 67 billion pesos in COVID funds. The chairman of the Senate's Blue Ribbon Committee, Senator Richard Gordon, says that they will recommend the removal of Duque if it is proven that the health secretary has done wrong.
I didn't want to do an investigation because I knew they had 60 days to complete it. But I said, what is important is alamin natin muna yung mga nurses. Nababayaran ba yung mga nurses sa pinangako ng gobyerno? Because pag nawalan tayo ng tao sa ospital, hindi na pumasok yung mga nurses. Pilay ang system.
Overpriced sanitary napkins purchased from an obscure hardware store. Yet another government purchase being questioned by the country's state auditors. The items were acquired by the Overseas Welfare Administration, or the OWA. The OWA's administrator, Hans Leokakdak, says that his agency will clarify the matter in due time. But there are other audit findings that Kakdak has yet to respond to. Among them, the purchase of overpriced thermal scanners, as well as 300,000 pesos worth of cupcakes and bottled water. State auditors are also calling out the Philippine Sports Authority for their, quote, unnecessary, improper, and wasteful use of public funds. After the sports body spent nearly 11 million pesos on improvements for a training facility at a site in La Union. One of the improvements in question was a brand new infinity pool. The Sports Authority, however, claims that improvements like this infinity pool make their facility more attractive as a venue for local and international conferences. They add that these upgrades will also bring in more non-traditional revenue for the agency. A former Commission on Auditor is refuting Malacanang's claim that the annual audit reports on the spending of the health department and other agencies are just preliminary observations. Heidi Mendoza clarifies that those are already comprehensive assessments of how these agencies manage their financial accounts and operations back in 2020. She says that the COA will continue to monitor whether or not these agencies have complied with their recommendations.
With due respect to the presidential spokesperson, ano po, hindi ho pwedeng sabihing premature. May proseso po yan. Ipapadala po yan sa ahensya. Sasagot po ang ahensya bago pa po magbubuo ng audit observation. Pagdating po ng year 2021, may section ng audit report. Ang tinatawag po yun doon ay yung monitoring of prior year's recommendation. Doon po papasok yon para pong mag-a-update.
Earlier this week, presidential spokesperson Harry Roque said that President Duterte lashed out at the state auditors after he was frustrated with the fact that his government was being condemned of corruption on the basis of initial observations. The Philippine government is seeking its biggest national budget in history. Malacanang says that they will propose an over 5 trillion peso budget for 2022, nearly 12% higher than last year's spending plan. The social services sector will receive the lion's share of the proposed budget at 38%, followed by the economic services sector, as well as the general public services sector. Of all the agencies, the country's education agency will receive the highest allocation of over 773 billion pesos. Coming in second in terms of budget is the Public Works Department, followed by the Interior Department. Malacanang says that the Budget Department aims to submit the spending proposal to Congress by Monday, August 23rd. A warning to all the social media influencers: pay proper taxes or face criminal charges. That's according to the Philippine Bureau of Internal Revenue. The BIR says that they have received reports that certain online personalities have not been paying their proper taxes from the huge income they receive from various social media platforms. They also say that some aren't even registered with the BIR, nor have they this, and they need to declare their earnings. According to the Bureau, influencers may be liable for business tax as well. Online content creators who fail to comply may be charged with tax evasion, which imposes a fine of up to 10 million pesos and jail time of no less than 6 years.
for those who are starting, I don't think you should be worried. It's really for those who are really making a lot of income already and not declaring and paying taxes. It's important that we understand the law, because if you are not making or earning above 100,000, that remains exempted as a marginal income earner. But the requisite is you have to register. But if you are not registered, then that is tax evasion.
Today, the Metro Manila Council may release their recommendation for the region's next quarantine classification. The council met Tuesday night to discuss this matter. The MMC chairman and Parañaque mayor, Edwin Olivares, earlier said their recommendation will be based on the effects of the ongoing enhanced community quarantine, which is set to end this Friday. The Philippines recorded another 10,000 new COVID-19 infections Tuesday, bringing the nationwide tally to 1,765,000. More than 105,000 of those are active cases. The health department's data shows that in just a week, the average number of daily infections in the country grew by almost 4,000. Meanwhile, the Philippine Genome Center detects the Delta variant in more sequenced samples. In the latest batch of 373 samples, 182, or almost 49%, were positive of the highly contagious Delta variant. Another hospital in Metro Manila is declaring full capacity due to the rising number of COVID-19 cases. The Pasay City General Hospital announced that they can no longer accept patients for their COVID ward, as well as for their emergency room and intensive care units. They're also temporarily closing their obstetrics and gynecology services. Several other hospitals in Metro Manila are in the same situation. Severe cases make up the biggest percentage of current hospital admissions in the capital region, up by nearly 200% in the last month. This is followed by critical cases, which have also doubled.
Nasa 72% na yung ICU utilization sa Metro Manila. At hindi ito agad-agad bababa kasi dahil tumataas pa yung bilang ng kaso. Ibig sabihin, mananatili siyang above 70% at maaring umakyat pa siya. Yung hospital bed occupancy natin sa Metro Manila, tumataas rin. Nasa 64% na. Maaari na siyang umabot ng 70% based on sa projection namin by next week. Ibig sabihin yan, yun nga, baka magiging factor ito kung ano yung magiging decision ng IATF whether to extend yung quarantine or kung ibababa na sa something like MECQ.
Regional hospitals are also facing a deluge of COVID-19 cases. The Cagayan Valley Medical Center in Tuguegarao now has nearly 300 infected patients. The hospital had to rent 2 hotels to serve as step-down facilities for those recovering patients so that they could free up some beds.
Naabot na naman po muli namin ang pinaka-record high, no, mula po noong nagsimula ang pandemic dito sa ating bansa. Meron po pa kasi tayong 27 na pasyente, no, na nandoon sa ating waiting area at kasalukuyan na po silang ina-admit ngayon dahil doon sa mga waiting natin.
In Iligan City, the Adventist Medical Center has announced that they are now fully occupied. The hospital is now appealing to their patients to seek treatment at other health facilities. Authorities in Zamboanga City are investigating how several foreigners were able to enter without presenting swab test results. Zamboanga's COVID-19 task force says that the foreigners, who later on tested positive for COVID-19, were denied entry at first as they were unable to present RT-PCR test results. The foreigners have already recovered from COVID-19 and contact tracing is ongoing.
Some of them already left the city, but still, yung contact tracing natin has to do more effort in that aspect. Para at least naman ma-determine natin kung sino-sino ang who they were, who were with them. And then of course to also advise the other LGUs kung nandun sila sa area nila.
Zamboanga has 266 active COVID-19 cases. Authorities say that the city has 2,000 beds ready in case of a surge in infections. Almost one-third of Filipinos do not have access to COVID-19 vaccination sites. That's according to a new social weather station survey conducted late June. Luzon topped the areas with the least accessible vaccination sites at 35%. This is followed by the Visayas with 29%, Mindanao at 26%, and the National Capital Region at 16%. 68% or a majority of those who had access to inoculation centers were from the NCR. Meanwhile, around 50% of Filipinos believe that the government's vaccine rollout is still slow, more than 6 months since it began. So far, the Philippines has administered 28.3 million COVID-19 shots. A total of 12.7 million people have been fully vaccinated. The higher vaccination targets are largely unfulfilled in the areas under strict quarantine in the country. Government data shows that fewer people receive COVID-19 shots, even as authorities hope to simultaneously ramp up vaccinations together with the quarantine curbs. An average of over 475,000 doses were administered daily from August 9th to the 15th. That's down from 516,000 the previous week. The Pandemic Task Force official Carlito Galvez Jr. says that local governments have had to divide their focus. Instead of just concentrating on the vaccinations, they've had to handle a rise in COVID-19 cases, as well as the distribution of aid and quarantine cash. Elsewhere in the world, the United Kingdom's health regulator has approved Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine for use in children ages 12 to 17 years old. The Medicine and the Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency says that they did not identify any new side effects, with the adverse effects being mostly mild to moderate. Moderna's jab was recommended for use in adolescents by the European regulators in July and is now awaiting U.S. authorization. Earlier in June, the UK gave the green light to the use of Pfizer's vaccine on 12 to 15-year-olds ahead of the reopening of schools next month. While most children develop mild or no symptoms, they are still able to spread the virus, and some remain at risk of becoming seriously ill. Qantas Airways is requiring all of its employees to get vaccinated. The airline said that pilots, cabin crew members, and airport workers will need to be fully vaccinated by November 15th. The rest of their employees will have until March 31st, 2022 to complete their shots. A staff poll found that 89% of Qantas's workers have already been vaccinated or are planning to get vaccinated. Qantas Airways' CEO, Alan Joyce, says that the path to vaccination will end the cycle of lockdowns and border closures, which will put a lot of Qantas employees back to work. Earlier this month, the airline temporarily put about 2,500 employees into idle without pay in a bid to cope with the fresh COVID-19 restrictions in Australia. Qantas joins other airlines like United, Cathay Pacific, and Hawaiian Airlines to mandate their employees to get vaccinated. New Zealand records an additional 4 COVID-19 cases, including an Auckland hospital worker. The new infections have been confirmed as the Delta variant and are linked to the first case reported on Tuesday. New Zealand's first COVID-19 infection in 6 months.
We have a positive case.
Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern to place Auckland under lockdown for 7 days and the rest of the country for 3 days.
A case of the Delta variant.
Back here at home, the Energy Department is assuring the public that there will be no power outages during the 2022 polls. The agency admits that power reserves may be thin during the election season, however, but they are making all the necessary preparations to prevent these brownouts. They add that they're pushing for the development of new power sources, including natural gas renewables and nuclear power even.
The confidence lies because of our track record. We have been looking at this very early on. So the preparation is quite early as far as the energy family is concerned. And yes, there are challenges, but there are also solutions. And we see the solutions already. So it's just a matter of following through.
Meralco, the largest power distributor in the country, also says that they are prepared for the upcoming polls.
For actual elections, we make sure that all our facilities are ready to respond to any emergency. We have strategically located crews ready to respond. We have mobile gen sets. And we are working closely with the entire energy family to ensure that the Meralco franchise will be brownout free. But in case of isolated interruptions, then we will be ready to respond accordingly.
Earlier this year, the Energy Department also made assurances that there would be no power outages during the dry season. But brownouts still occurred due to unplanned maintenance work at power plants. We're taking a quick break. Still to come, dozens of overseas Filipino workers are evacuated from Afghanistan. That story and more up next on The Rundown. Please stay tuned.
Araw-araw sa eskwela, nagkakasubukan ng galing. Gano'ng kagaling ang batso ko?
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The death toll from the major earthquake that struck Haiti last weekend surged to close to 2,000 on Tuesday as the search for survivors resumed after Tropical Storm Grace hit overnight. Hospitals struggled to tend to all those injured, with many people still missing or under the rubble. Heavy rain fell over Lakai, the southern coastal city that bore the brunt of the 7.2 magnitude quake. Inside a tent city, hundreds of people scrambled to repair makeshift coverings made of wooden poles and tarps that were destroyed by Grace. Some took cover under plastic sheets.
The rain fell on top of us. We slept sitting down on chairs. Nobody has come to help us. We have no tarps. We sleep here sitting down. I don't want to go home. I am in God's hands.
It's not good here by the coast. My home was destroyed. I have nothing, nothing to use to sleep. Look, there's lots of children here. I really have nothing.
The storm complicated rescue efforts and made it difficult to provide aid and relief to hundreds of thousands left struggling for food, water, or shelter. according to Haitian authorities, with about 37,312 houses destroyed by the quake, and many of those still unexcavated, the death toll is expected to rise. Haiti's latest natural disaster comes just over a month after Haiti was plunged into political turmoil by the assassination of President Jovenel Moïse on July 7th.
The Taliban looks to calm fears following their takeover of Afghanistan. In the group's first news conference since their takeover, the Taliban spokesperson Zabihullah Mujahid spoke of bringing Afghans together, saying that all groups confronting them are forgiven in the interest of peace and stability in Afghanistan. Mujahid adds that private media can continue to be free and independent in Afghanistan. He adds that everyone, including women, will be allowed to return to work where permitted.
نظام باندې کار روان دی دا اوس زموږ مشرتابه په جدیت سره بوخته دی چې نظام جوړونې لپاره پروسه تکمیل کړي او نظام به جوړ شي په دې باندې په جدیت سره کار روان تاسو ته بیا اطمینان درکوم او کله چې منتظر پاتې شو تکمیل شي او بیا موږ اعلان واورو.
During their 1996 to 2001 rule, the Taliban, also guided by Islamic law, prevented women from working and barred girls from going to school. While Britain has urged countries not to recognize the legitimacy of the Taliban, the European Union says that they will cooperate with the new Afghan government for as long as they respect the fundamental rights of people there, including that of women. Thirty-five Filipinos evacuated by their companies from Afghanistan arrived in Manila Tuesday night. The repatriates were flown out from Doha, Qatar, on a flight chartered by the Department of Foreign Affairs. Last Sunday, the DFA issued Alert Level 4 in Afghanistan, advising Filipinos there to prepare for a mandatory evacuation. A Filipino in Afghanistan told ABS-CBN News that he is with 18 other compatriots at an evacuation center near the Kabul International Airport, awaiting for the opportunity to fly out. He also shared that the Taliban had already attempted to enter their compound.
Meron pong attempt na andiyan na sila sa gate. Yun nga lang talagang nagpapasalamat nga ako dahil maganda talaga ang servisyo ng British security company namin at hindi sila nag-succeed. Parang naitaboy.
The DFA says that they are working nonstop to explore all the options to ensure the safety of Filipinos in Afghanistan. Malacanang, meanwhile, says that the Philippines is willing to receive Afghan asylum seekers. They add that they're leaving it up to the DFA whether or not to establish diplomatic channels with the Taliban. The United States has completed a drawdown of personnel from its embassy in the Afghan capital of Kabul. According to the State Department, diplomatic staff remaining in Afghanistan are helping with the evacuation of other American citizens and Afghan allies. A White House official says 1,100 U.S. citizens, permanent residents, and their families have been flown out of Afghanistan so far. Evacuation flights out of Kabul resumed Monday following the chaos that was prompted by the Taliban's takeover.
Right now, Nick, we're focused on the mission at hand. And the mission at hand is precisely what I was describing to you. That is an effort to relocate, in some cases repatriate to the United States, in other cases to relocate to third countries, as many individuals as we can over as much time as we might have. Right now, we are thinking about this in terms of August 31st. If it is safe and responsible for us to potentially stay longer, that is something that we may be able to look at.
Meanwhile, people fleeing the Taliban's rule in the United Kingdom arrived in the UK Tuesday. Britain planned to relocate 5,000 people as part of its Afghan relocations and assistance policy. But they also announced a new evacuation scheme that would prioritize women, girls, and minorities. The U.S. freezes roughly $10 billion in assets of Afghanistan's central bank as they try to keep the Taliban from accessing government money. Shipments of cash to the war-torn country were also stopped. Sources say the decision was made by U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen and officials at the Treasury's Office of Foreign Assets Control. DA Afghan Bank has $9.5 billion in assets, most of which are held in accounts in the United States. Meanwhile, Afghanistan's currency dropped to a record low as the acting central bank governor fled the country. The Afghani fell as much as 4.6% on Tuesday, a fourth day of decline following the Taliban's swift and chaotic takeover of the country. The chaos and desperation in Afghanistan is a shame to the West, those words coming from Germany's President Frank-Walter Steinmeier as the government works on evacuating its people and Afghan civilians. Here's the full story.
Thousands of Afghan civilians desperate to flee Taliban rule have thronged Kabul airport in the past few days, to the shame of Western nations, according to Germany's President Frank-Walter Steinmeier on Tuesday. Germany, which had the second largest military contingent in Afghanistan after the United States, said it would work with its partners in the European Union to provide aid to neighboring countries facing an influx of Afghan civilians. The country's foreign minister, Heiko Maas, speaking ahead of an EU foreign minister's emergency meeting, said Berlin was working to get as many people as possible out of Afghanistan, among them German-Afghan dual nationals, as well as rights activists, lawyers, and people who worked with foreign forces. Kawa Spartak manages an Afghan refugee organization in Berlin and says Germany must take a leading role in helping Afghans to get out.
Particularly the German government have missed a lot of opportunities. They have missed the opportunities to evacuate people. They have missed the opportunities to inform their own population about the security in Afghanistan. They were actually more concentrated on deportations.
The UN refugee agency UNHCR, meanwhile, called for an immediate halt to forced deportations of Afghan asylum seekers. Austria, which insisted it plans to keep deporting illegal immigrants back to Afghanistan, even as the Taliban seized Kabul, has suggested setting up deportation centres in nearby countries as an alternative. A photograph showing more than 600 Afghan men, women and children crouching on the floor of a US military plane has gone viral on social media, shining a spotlight on the plight of Afghan civilians who want to flee.
A Paralympic athlete from Afghanistan is appealing for help to get into Tokyo to join the Games this month. Zakia Khodadadi is seeking a way out of Kabul to fulfill her dreams of becoming the country's first female competitor at a Paralympic game. The para-taekwondo athlete is currently with her extended family, but is unable to train amid the chaos in her country. She is one of two Paralympic athletes who are supposed to represent Afghanistan at the Games. They were supposed to arrive in Japan this week, but the country's Olympic Committee has already announced that they will not be able to compete. And that was the rundown. I'm Mikey Oreta. We'll be back with more news at 11. Please stay safe and see you back here then.
There still is a lot.